Good morning and happy Sabbath. We welcome you to worship with us at GSDAC online worship. Now I would like to read a verse from the Bible to give us strength at this moment. Isaiah 41 verse 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Let us worship the Lord with spirit and truth. Our reading His Word together this Sabbath morning is written in Isaiah 1 verse 15 until 18. I will read verse 15 and the congregation will read the next verse, and we will end by reading together verse 18. Isaiah 1 verse 15. When you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Verse 16, congregation. Verse 17, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, plead for the widow. Verse 18, together. Come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though you are red like crimson, they shall be as wool.
Let us bow our head for a moment. Oh Heavenly Father, thank you so much, O God, for gathering us in the temple of time as we meditate upon your word to get your blessing to be strengthened for our life. We'd like to ask that you may grant us with pure understanding, so that after the sermon, we'll get such a blessing, a message that we can apply in our life. Thank you so much, O God, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Because we're a family, and these folks are so near. When one has a heartache, we all share the tears and rejoice in his victory in this family so dear.
I'm so glad
the door of an orphanage to the house of the king. No longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags unto riches, from the weak to the strong, I'm not worthy.
Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. As we are going to pray, let us, as much as possible, kneel down and pray. Let us pray. Almighty God in heaven, you are the God who can do all things. You reign over all power and might are in your hands. When you decree, it come to pass. I praise you today and always, and thank you for being God. Lord Jesus, I come to you today and thank you for the privilege of praying for your congregation. I thank you that through your name I can come boldly before you and pray with confidence according to your will, and I know that you will hear us. I pray you today for our nations and around the world who are currently suffering because of the COVID pandemic, that you care and comfort will be with us all. May your strength can strengthen us to always have hope in you in these difficult circumstances. I pray to you, O loving God, that your word will have the power in changing people, changing sinners to come to you. Father, I pray for my fellow believers who are in weak spiritually, that they will be strengthened with might in their inner man by the Holy Spirit. I pray, O Lord, for my church family, that they can give good influence to others. Let them be a salt and light, pointing others to you, O Lord. Deepen their love for you and for the people around them. Guard them from hypocrisy or from going into temptation that could harm the cause of Christ. I pray for the lost, the hurting, the lonely, the bereaved, and those who are imprisoned, whether with invisible wall and visible wall. Send your comfort, your peace, and your calming presence. So many in need, O Lord Jesus, but you are adequate for every need. Your name is powerful, and your power is great. So it's in your name, Lord Jesus, our Savior's name, I pray and believe. Amen.
To come to church this Sabbath, but thank God for the technology, we still be able to meet one another through online streaming. Let's continue to pray for our church, for our country, and everyone, our friends, our family, so So everything will be done and finished soon so that all of us can worship back again at church together. Now this is the time for you, a special time where we are going to listen to the story from the Bible. Do you have your Bible with you? Maybe you can ask your mom and dad to get one of the Bible for you. I'll wait here. And while waiting for the kids, I would like to encourage the parents as much as possible to dress up the family as if we are in a church. By doing this, hopefully all of us can feel the atmosphere of Sabbath worship, especially for the children. Alright, kids, are you ready? Yes? Okay. Before we open the Bible, I have prepared something for you. Something really special. Are you ready to receive it? Okay, here we go. So I would like to give you this one. Heart. And another heart for you. And there's another heart. What do you think? Is that a nice heart? Do you like it? Not really. You don't think it's nice? Well, I guess so. It's not really nice heart. Some of it even has a tear. But what do you think if I give you another heart? Maybe a heart looks nicer a bit? Something like this? Would you like prefer to have this one? Yes? Yes, you can have this one. It's easy. You just give me the old one back and I give you this one. And give me back the old one heart and I give you the new heart. And give back the old one and I give you the new one. That's pretty easy, right? All you need to do is just ask and swap the old one with the new one. See, the really thing about our life as a Christian, similar like this. We all got the new heart, not the heart like the one in here, inside here, the one who pump our blood or like a transplant heart. No, but a heart, when a new heart, when we see Jesus, when we know Jesus. So we all born with sin, and God doesn't like sin. But He promised us if we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, He will give us a new heart. And today's Bible story has something to do with that. Are you ready? Let's start. The story is about a man named Zacchaeus. Have you heard about it? Do you know him? Yes? Maybe somebody will raise their hand and say, I know that auntie. He's a man who was very short. He was climbed the tree to meet Jesus. That's correct. But the story of Zacchaeus has a lot more than a story of being short. It's a story about a man who finally changed his heart and have a new heart because of Jesus. Zacchaeus, well known as a very bad person, and people doesn't like him. You know why? Because he was a tax collector. You know what tax collector is? Somebody who took people's money. And when people take your money, you will not like it, right? So people will talk around and say, do not make friends with him. Do not play with him. Do not even come to his house because it was so bad. And they even tell about it to Jesus. But when Jesus came, he see different things. And he want to make friends with Zacchaeus. And when Jesus was there, Zacchaeus, remember, he climbed the tree because he really want to see Jesus. And Jesus said, hi Zacchaeus, what are you doing? Come down, I want to come to your house and want to have dinner with you. Wow, everybody was surprised. They don't believe it because they don't even want to play with him. But Jesus see things differently. He wants to be friends with Zacchaeus. And after that, you know, when Zacchaeus met Jesus and spent time with Jesus, Zacchaeus really see something very special about Jesus. He learned things from Jesus and he decided to change into a new person. He has received a new heart and he finally said, okay, I know the things that I did before was not right. And I want to return it back to people. The money that I took, I'm going to return it back. And I'm even give some more than what I had before from them. So friends, kids, you see, people like Zacchaeus, although he was so bad before, when he know Jesus, when he spent time with Jesus, he learned from Jesus, he completely become a new person. He received a new heart. Same like me and you. We are born with sin, but if we know Jesus, we spend time with Jesus, we'll know, we learn about God, and then we can also receive a new heart. So let's do that. How? By spending time with God. Spending time by reading the Bible. You can do that, right? And God's love doesn't stop right there. We also need to give it the love of God to other people, showing our love and care to our people by showing a good stuff to other people. We're doing good things, helping people. We can also share God's love through our action, our words, and everything. So remember that we need to show God's love to other people. So now I need you to open your Bible with me. Let's open up. Our key text is coming from Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Let's open. Ask your mom and dad to help you. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Are you there? I'll wait for you. Ezekiel before Daniel. It's in the Old Testament. Okay? Ready? Let's read it together. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. See, that's a promise from God in the Bible, that He will be the one who give us a new heart. We just need to, same like our activity before, we just need to give our old heart, and God will give you a new heart. So kids, let's do that. And maybe after this, when you got to meet your friends at school, be nice to them, play with them, and share about God's love to other people. That's all. Can you do that? Can you say amen? I cannot hear you. Can you say amen? Amen. All right. Now let us pray and ask God to help us so that we can share His love also to other people. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the Sabbath day. Thank you for the story. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the grace that you give us. Help us to be your children and help us to share about your love to other people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Right, kids? See you next Sabbath. Bye. Thank you.
in to bring your offerings. There is this lady named Jackie who was giving a Bible study to Martha. Martha asked Jackie, "When are we expected to bring an offering to God, Jackie? Should it be monthly, every Sabbath when there is gratitude in my heart, or a call from the pulpit when I know about a good project, or even when I feel that this is the moment to give? Is there a biblical principle that I could use to determine when I should give offerings?" Jackie replied, "While the Bible says that no one should come before the Lord empty-handed on Deuteronomy 16 verse 16, it is also true that the Lord does not expect us to bring anything before He gives us something. Paul says that it is accepted according to what one has and not according to what he does not have on 2 Corinthians 8 verse 12. It is God's giving that should start human giving." Martha asked a question again. "Do you mean that we should bring offerings every time we tithe?" "Well," said Jackie, "in Malachi 3 verse 8, there is a clear indication that both tithes and offerings are equally required and expected. And the context also shows that not giving any of them would lead to separation from God and material ruin, as well as moral and spiritual decay. And Solomon also provides a general principles about the regularity of offerings. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits, the first part or the best part of all your increase, in Proverbs 3 verse 8. He means that the regularity with which we honor God should be established by the frequency of the increase or the income as we do with the tithe. So, tithes and offerings must be given every time there is a blessing, an increase, or income as a reminder that God is the source of the blessing. God's messenger for these last days says that this matter of giving is not left to impulse. God has given us definite instruction in regard to it. He has specified tithes and offerings as the measure of our obligation, and He desires us to give regularly and systematically, as it is written on Councils on Stewardship, page 80. Martha asked Jackie, "Would you like to become a promiser, vowing to also give offerings as regularly as the Lord blesses you?" An appeal to all of us. As regularly as He blesses us, let us also bring what is due to Him. Now, let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the blessings that you've showered upon us throughout the week and throughout this situation. And now as we are gonna return our offerings and tithes to you, please help us to have the willing heart to give it willingly and gracefully, and please accept our offerings. Please forgive all our sins. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God's messenger for these last days says that this matter of giving is not left to impulse. God has given us definite instruction in regard to it. He has specified tithes and offerings as the measure of our obligation, and He desires us to give regularly and systematically, as it is written on Councils on Stewardship, page 80. Martha asked Jackie, "Would you like to become a promiser, vowing to also give offerings as regularly as the Lord blesses you?" An appeal to all of us. As regularly as He blesses us, let us also bring what is due to Him. Now, let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the blessings that you've showered upon us throughout the week and throughout this situation. And now, as we are gonna return our offerings and tithes to you, please help us to have the willing heart to give it willingly and gracefully, and please accept our offerings. Please forgive all our sins. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
The scripture selection, the Sabbath morning, is written in James 4, verse 8. James 4, verse 8 says, "Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded."
Right from where my family and I live, I would like to greet you all. Happy Sabbath, Church! It has been 2 Sabbaths now we do our worship at home. We miss you all already. Though we are separated right now, but we still worship the same God. And I believe that God, through our worship, unites us. This condition, in a sense, reminds us for what Jesus said to the Samaritan woman. He said, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship Him." Are not us in our condition right now doing the same? We are worshiping our God. Aside from Sabbath, we are praying intensely on the other days too. You see, despite this situation, we are actually connected. We are connected in our worship and prayers for healing and strength. Nowadays, we regularly exercise hand washing as a preventive way towards the spread of COVID-19. I'm going to talk about it, but it will not be related to this virus. Instead, I would like to bring our attention to what Bible says about hand washing and why it should be done. I intentionally chose this topic because right now, when we are so limited to go horizontally around, we still have a full access to approach the throne of God as we also meditate for ourselves. Hopefully, the discussion may bless somebody's life. The question is, why do we wash our hands? It is done for a matter of cleansing, most of the time. In the Bible, there are a few instances where hand washing appears. It is interesting to know in what regards or for what reason did the people in the Bible wash their hands. But why hands? Hands may be a representative of the entirety of a person. Hands represent our actions or what we do, either good or bad. Hence, hand washings points to something beyond itself. I would like to add, for the sake of information, that washing hands, or in Hebrew terminology, neshiyelat yedayim, in Judaism, is performed in relation to the sanctuary and synagogue services. Besides, concerning to meals and other daily activities. This practice is primarily related to a religious deed and not a hygienic act. By rabbis, although not all of them agree with this ordinance, there are a concept of impurity of the hands behind the practice. So, before they lift up their hands in holiness and praise to the Lord, their hands should be cleansed thoroughly. Be clean before cleansing. Perhaps we could sense an irony here because before exercising this ritual washing, the hands must be thoroughly cleansed. It means that your hands should be clean even before this ritual cleansing. Rings must be removed from our fingers to allow water reach all parts of your hands. So the hand washing is done for another kind of cleansing. How about the type of water used? The water should be neither hot or discolored. How about the method? The method of ritual washing is either by immersion up to the wrist or by pouring a specific amount of water over both hands up to the wrist. It is customary to perform the act by alternately pouring water over each hand 3 times. Your right hand will get washed first and then your left hand. Now, let us see 4 different hand washings mentioned in the Bible. Let us see the first one. Washing hands for sanctuary services, or we may add for synagogue services. This hand washing was practiced by the priest who ministered at sanctuary. Everything should be performed accordingly. They should leave their shoes or sandals before entering the church. The sanctuary. They should wash their hands and their feet. Failure to comply with this regulation would desecrate the holiness of the sanctuary and also would invalidate the service of any ministering priest. The idea in doing this were to get rid of all defilements in the presence of God, said Ellen G. White. Now coming to the second part, washing hands for purification, or you may add, but only in your mind, hygienic purpose. We have some Bible references about hand washing for purification purpose exercised in the community of believers. That is due to their daily contacts with someone or something defiled. Another occurrence about hand washing tradition occurs also in the Gospels, that is prior partaking the food. I learned that one of the reasons for hand washing was based on the concept of comparison between the dining table and the altar upon which the sacrifice service was performed. People took their food from the dining table, and God took the offering from the altar. It was by the priest this custom was spread to the people with the idea that we should maintain purified hands when we are partaking our food. The food on the table, we believe, are provided by God's blessing. So we should respect it before partaking it. Paul, as a converted Pharisee, says, whether you eat or drink, do all to the glory of God. Coming to the third part, washing hands to show innocency. This part is another irony in itself, since hand washing was performed to achieve a kind of purification. But here hand washing was performed to show innocency. Let us take Job as the first instance. Job was arguing about that in the midst of fiery judgment of his own friends. He said, if I wash myself with snow water and make my hands never so clean, yet shall thou plunge me in the ditch, and mine own clothes shall abhor me. King David also said something similar in meaning, I will wash my hands in innocence so that I may process around your altar, Lord. Previously, he said something similar with Psalm chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Asaph, in his jealousy for the fortunate of the wicked, spoke of his hopelessness. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. From these instances, we learn that as a fallen race, our innocency is stained. We wash our hands, but deep in our hearts, there is a voice contradicting the action. Prophet Isaiah said, but we are all like an unclean thing. and all our righteousnesses are like filthy rags. Now coming to the last part, the last instance of this presentation, washing hands to abstain from responsibility. The last instance about hand washing is very different, since it adds another meaning to being innocent. It was Pilate, the governor. He washed his hands before the accusers and said, "I am innocent of the blood of this just person." Some monks of the early days jokingly questioned if Pilate used soap when he did hand washing. It was not for hygienic purpose that Pilate did it. As a matter of fact, soap will never be able to cleanse us from guilt. A soap advertisement depicted a little fellow looking intently at his shadow that fell across his pathway. The slogan underneath the picture reads, "That's the only thing I can't wash out." This was what was happening in Pilate's life. We can be sure that Pilate washed his hands to support what he said about not being responsible for Jesus' death penalty. Yet he was the one who handed over Jesus to the bloodthirsty multitude. I like the way Ellen G. White commented about what Pilate did. She wrote, "Oh Pilate, if you could have washed from your conflicting conscience the terrible guilt that will ever oppress you, your soul, because of this cowardly deed, your after history would not have been laid in such dark colors. Do you think that the act of washing your hands will cleanse you from the sin of condemning a man when your own reason tells you that he was delivered into your power because of envy? You declared him innocent, and yet you deliver him up to his murderers." What Pilate did and said at first contradicted with what he did later on. John correctly records these contradictive things. Have a look on John chapter 18 through chapter 19. First, let us see verse 31 of chapter 18. "Then Pilate said to them, 'You take him and judge him according to your law.' Therefore, the Jews said to him, 'It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death.'" The Jews had no right for capital punishment. The crowds realize it. John chapter 19, verse 1. "So then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him." You see, even before finding any fault in Jesus, Pilate had given Jesus a severe whip. Coming to verse 4 in chapter 19 informs that Pilate said to multitude, "Behold, I find no fault in him." Verse 16, "Then he delivered him to them to be crucified." What a contradiction we find here. Another good quotation from Ellen G. White associates Pilate with liquor traders, lawmakers, she wrote, and liquor dealers may wash their hands as did Pilate, but they will not be clean from the blood of souls. The ceremony of washing their hands will not cleanse them when by their influence or agency they have helped to make men drunkards. They will be held accountable for the millions of dollars that have been wasted in consuming the consumers. No one can blind himself to the terrible results of the drink traffic. The daily papers show that the wretchedness the poverty, the crime that result from this traffic are not cunningly devised fables, and that hundreds of men are growing rich of the pittance of the men they are sending to perdition by their dreadful drink business. Oh, that a public sentiment might be created that would put an end to the drink traffic, close the saloons, and give this maddened man a chance to think on eternal realities. Now the question is, do you think Pilate was free from this guilt? The answer is no, he wasn't. After showing you these four different types of hand washings from the Bible, I would like to conclude with a simple statement. Church, believe this. In spiritual sense, we need more than just hand washing. We need God, because only He can cleanse us in a way that is beyond what we can do to our hands. When God washes us, it is not only our hands, but He will wash us from all our guilt and sin. Our part is only to let Him do it for us. In the situation where we are imprisoned by our guilt and sins, it is best for us to consider our spiritual life more seriously. Take the time to talk with God through your earnest prayers right now. Please, hand washing is never enough to purify our soul. We need another level of soul washing. May God bless you. Amen. Let us pray. After listening to four different kinds of hand washings, we are well informed that nobody can wash or cleanse our life from iniquity, sins, and guilt. We need you, O Lord, to cleanse us. We need you, O Lord, to cleanse our soul so that we can see ourselves different. Comes to realize that you are really the God who can purify our life. Make sure, O God, that this message can come deeply to our hearts, that can enable us to see our needs, the needs of your hands to wash clean in our life. Thank you so much, O God, for such an opportunity to listen, to learn, to study upon your word. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Church, let us receive the blessing from God. Today, O God, we claim your blessing because you are the only source of life, the only source of true happiness, the only source of holiness for our life. We commit ourselves unto thee as you continually bless us, and we as your people will continually be walking under your guidance. May the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ and the companionship of Holy Spirit be upon each one of us from now on until Maranatha. In Jesus' name, Amen.